Very grateful for that.
London Fanshawe.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Last fall, I asked the minister about the many veterans and families struggling to access supports from Veterans Affairs. His response to my question left me wondering if he is hearing the many voices pleading with his government to listen and make the simple but important changes needed. Just last week at the Veterans Affairs Committee, we heard from the spouse of a veteran who highlighted very succinctly what I have been hearing for years. She said her husband, Mark, who was released from the military, was left with the impression that he was just another number. And sadly, this indifference has continued now that he is a veteran. This testimony highlights the fact that we are failing our injured veterans and their families. The Department of National Defence and the Department of Veterans Affairs are failing the men and women who serve this country. Mr. Speaker, the minister should know very well by now that our veterans and their families are struggling. Medically releasing veterans have to wait to access their pensions when they leave, putting an already stressed family in financial hardship. Veterans and their families are also left without knowing what supports they will qualify for, leaving them with more questions about the financial resources on which they rely. In addition to financial support are the psychological supports that must be in place immediately. Waiting for a referral from VAC and the additional 6 weeks before a veteran can see a doctor at an OSI clinic is shocking and unacceptable. If we're able to immediately help the veteran in need, it will reduce the pressure and potential trauma for the veteran's family. The current system is failing not only our veterans, but also their families. More supports for spouses caring for veterans are essential. They may need help to repair a damaged relationship, resources to assist with learning how to live with and help someone with PTSD, and supports for their own trauma. None of these resources should be difficult to access. They should be readily available as soon as they are needed. And these are just some of the struggles that veterans and their families face today. But I get very worried, Mr. Speaker, about the future. And as these veterans age, they and their families will struggle again, struggle to access specialized care that the veteran might need. Right now, we have long-term care facilities, such as the one in my riding, Parkwood Hospital, that have expertise in serving the special needs of veterans. But post-Korean War veterans and peacekeepers cannot access these specialized facilities. As a result, these hospitals are slated to slowly shutter their doors. I noticed today that the minister visited my riding and made an announcement that he would open 5 beds in Parkwood Hospital. These beds have been sitting empty in the hospital for years. We need more beds and space to help veterans. Parkwood has the facilities to help veterans struggling to access long-term care, but the government lacks the political will to make this happen. They are content to download veteran care to the provinces. The announcement today does nothing to address the lack of a long-term plan for modern-day veterans. If we don't start to expand care, we're going to lose the expertise housed in facilities like Parkwood. So with much more work to be done to support the veterans, I wonder what the minister and his parliamentary secretary would like to share with this House in regard to how they will address the financial and healthcare hardships medically released veterans and their families face when they leave the military. Will the government enact the military ombudsman's recommendations that all benefits and pensions be in place before a CF member is released from the military?
The Honourable Parliamentary Secretary to the Minister of Veterans Affairs.
Monsieur le Président.
Mr. Speaker, I want to thank the Honourable Member for having raised this important issue of benefits that Canada offers veterans and their families. We all know that Canada has a debt of gratitude to these veterans for the sacrifices that they've made and their service. We understand that when a man or a woman serves in the Canadian Armed Forces, the entire family serves alongside. As a mother of 2 Canadian Armed Forces members, I can confirm that. Once they This is why, in fact, Veterans Affairs Canada offers a number of services to veterans that will provide financial support to assistance following illness or an injury, and health services as well as services for well-being. Veterans Affairs Canada plays an essential role to support men and women who have served in uniform. It's the veteran's family that plays the main role. In the event that someone is sick or injured, Veterans Affairs Canada offers specific resources for families, for a caregiver, for example, and liaison services for long-term care, as well as mental health care services.
Integral to the work of the department and what we're doing. We've done a lot since November 2015 to improve veterans' access to benefits and resources, and we're continuing to look for ways we can better serve them. For example, we've reopened the 9 Veteran Affairs offices across the country that were closed by the previous government, including one in Sydney, Nova Scotia. We also opened a new office in Surrey, British Columbia, and we're extending our outreach in the north. Because mental health is a priority, we are committed to ensuring all veterans, eligible veterans and their families have the mental health support they need, when and where they need it. A new operational stress injury clinic opened in Dartmouth, Nova Scotia last June. We're working hard to find out how we can do better, how we can deliver the resources and services that veterans and their families need, when and where they need them. We are also working to simplify the process for applying for and accessing these benefits. And there is a robust arm's length appeal process to address any issues that veterans or their family members may have with Veterans Affairs Canada. We're here to listen to veterans and their families. I urge anyone who has an issue accessing benefits and resources to reach out to the department or to their local MP. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for London Fanshawe.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. Today is Valentine's Day, and we've heard a lot about the importance of love and caring for one another. And I know that the Parliamentary Secretary cares very much about veterans and their families. For many months last year, she sat with me on the Veterans Affairs Committee and heard the same testimony, the same struggles, the same pain that our veterans and their families deal with on a daily basis. The issues and problems plaguing the Department of Veterans Affairs are many. The struggles of veterans and their families are real. But an important question remains. What is the government doing and going to do about the barriers that veterans face? What actions, what changes will it make to ensure that veterans and their families will no longer struggle to access services and receive the support that they so desperately need?
The Honourable Parliamentary Secretary.
Speaker, in fact, today being Valentine's Day, I had the great pleasure of visiting Pearly Rideau and spending Valentine's Day with my extended military family, our veterans. The secret to a successful transition to civilian life is to begin the process even before the Canadian Forces members leave the military. Veteran Affairs and the Department of National Defence have been working together over the past year to make that transition as seamless as possible for members and their families. They have closed a number of gaps that were not addressed by previous governments. And yes, there's still work to be done. And the departments will continue to work to improve not only the services, but how they're delivered to better meet the needs of veterans and their families. And I'm so happy to be working with the member opposite again on this important file. Thank you.